Last week, Alabama football coach Nick Saban made a comment during SEC Media Day. He said that he thought that agents were more like pimps. So I thought it might be interesting to catch up with an agent, a man that I respect, and that is Steve Baker, who's represented a number of NFL players, including quarterback Jeff Garcia. Are you a pimp?
I'm certainly not a pimp.
You've got a black shirt on now.
But no hat and
no fur coat, right?
I don't think I'd pass for a pimp.
When you heard the comments from Nick Saban, what was your first reaction to them?
Well, to be honest, to some extent, he's accurate. I mean, if he describes every agent, that's not fair. But there's a tremendous amount of abuses that go on. Athletes coming out of college have huge potential to make money, and as a result, there's a lot of abuses that occur. And I think a lot of them are easy marks. So I understand Nick Saban's frustration.
Are we coming to a doomsday on all of this? And I say that because what we've got is money's involved in it. You've got athletes that want to make that money. You've got the NCAA that's trying to oversee the big business of college sports. You've got agents that are trying to top other agents to get these athletes to make the money that they can make. How do you see the environment that we're working in?
I actually believe the environment is in many ways better because there's so much money involved, there tends to be more sophistication. So increasingly, more athletes are sophisticated and aren't going to choose an agent based on being invited to a hot South Beach party. So I actually think the problem's probably not as bad as it might have been 20 years ago, back in the Norby Walters era. But what you have is you have the NCAA, certainly acts in interests that I think in many ways are just the NCAA's interests. You have colleges that frequently act in just their interest. You have agents who frequently act in just their interest. I think there's a problem there. I think certainly, I think the colleges should be worrying about the athletes, and I think the NCAA should be worrying about the athletes, and the agents should be worrying about the athletes.
Is there any scrutiny or control over the agents, Steve?
Yes. There's the principal source of scrutiny is in team sports. Agents are licensed by their various unions. And for example, to represent an NFL player, you need to receive a license from the NFL Players Association. And the NFLPA has suspended a number of agents for violating the rules. And my understanding is they're fairly seriously investigating some abuses right now.
How do they scrutinize them? I mean, what do they do? I understand they make them pass a test. Is that correct?
Well, I mean, there is a test. It certainly is not as complex as passing the bar exam. I mean, half the agents in the business I recognize as Batman villains back from the 60s series. I mean, the Riddler and the Joker. But, there is a test where you have to understand the various rules and understand the salary cap and understand the various benefit plans. And then there's a whole licensing arm that regulates to make sure that agents are in compliance with the rules. And, for example, if an agent illegally makes contacts with players in college, that agent could be suspended for several years.
How long have you been doing this?
I've been doing it for 24 years.
Let me go back to that first year. Mm-hmm. What was the landscape like in representing athletes? Tell me, and then compare it to today, how much bigger it is and what it's like.
Well, I mean, I started in 1986. And 1986 was a particularly interesting year because in that year, Norby Walters, who was a very successful music agent, one of the most powerful music agents in the business, ended up representing something like a third of the first round of the draft. And it later turned out that happened because he basically bought a third of the first round of the draft. And it raised some very serious issues because there were some issues about gambling, there was one allegation that a player might have made a mistake in the Rose Bowl that was on the take with someone. So there were a lot of abuses there. I think those kinds of things still exist now. But as I said, there's such a multiple of the players are making so much more now than then that as a result, there are many, many, many more top professionals that are doing it than were then. Now, with that said, there's still many abuses. I mean, for example, you have a 21-year-old kid who can't afford to go out to dinner, who in another month will be worth $50 million. There's obviously huge potential for abuse.
Yeah, you bring up the good point, and that is in another month they're going to be worth an awful lot of money. Why not wait for that one month?
It's unbelievable. I mean, I have seen top athletes pick agents because they were offered free phones. I mean, it is pathetic. And the reality is I understand Nick Saban's frustration, because the reality is there's absolutely nothing that an agent can do for a player while he's still in college. Nothing. I do believe there should be better resources for athletes while they're in college to help them to make the decision whether they're better off going pro or staying in college. And I think that's something that should be addressed. But it is utterly ridiculous that someone who has that kind of potential earning potential would be making decisions based on getting the kind of dinner or the kind of women they get introduced to, because those things will all be available to them a month later.
Are the athletes being squeezed on both sides? And what I mean by that is that they've got the agents on one side saying, hey, I want to represent you. This is what I can do for you. On the other side, they've got the Reggie Bush situation where you've got parents that are looking to get a better house. And they've got friends and everything whispering in their ears as well. You're shaking your head.
There's without question. There's a problem that who was pure in this process. And, you know, I know for a fact that there's never been a situation ever that I've advised a client in anything except what's in his best interest. But when you have a situation where a kid's parents will abuse the kid, the colleges abuse the kid, the teams abuse the kid, the agents abuse the kid, and you know, I think you then see the outgrowth of what you saw with LeBron James 2 weeks ago, where then there's sort of like a take back where the athlete wants to show that they're running the show. You know, there's just abuses on all sides.
Tell me about the colleges abusing the kid and the team abusing the kid. You just made that statement.
I mean, for example, college. I mean, you know, if a kid is there are certain situations where a kid is not in college to get an education, where he's solely in college to get a pro career. And if he goes to his, I mean, I think back, you know, I look at, I don't want to cite a particular athlete so as not to offend someone, but I've certainly seen situations where colleges have advised a kid to do something that might not be in that kid's best interest. And that's an abuse. As a general rule, a kid should stay in school his entire time. There are very few athletes that are ready to compete at a professional level before their senior year. But just you're dealing in a situation where the colleges are making a tremendous amount of money off the kid. The agents are making a tremendous amount of money. I mean, the NCAA's expansion to expanding the NCAA tournament, I don't believe was because they were looking for better basketball. It's because they were looking for a bigger paycheck. You know, the NFL looking to expand to 18 games isn't because they think that it'll be a more competitive, better season. It's not like we need two more games. It's because the almighty dollar. And the almighty dollar tends to frequently influence decisions that people make.
Would you agree with this statement that the corruption started back when they were coming out of high school and the recruiting process by the colleges to get the athletes in the first place?
I think the corruption starts even earlier than that. I mean, I think you see situations where people are beginning to scout 11 and 12-year-olds. I mean, it's really, I mean, just whenever there's money involved, there's the potential for abuse. I think it's particularly the high school recruiting process is the beginning of it. And you know, you see these athletes who don't have any kind of business sense initially, because unlike in any other profession, I mean, we were talking off air about, you know, the creativity that you've done in as a broadcaster all your years. I've obviously had to spend 25 years as a lawyer learning my trade. An athlete is not confronted with real business decisions until long after they're even really making money, because they go from making zero to making a tremendous amount based on talent as opposed to entrepreneurial skill. So there's a tremendous potential for abuse.
Steve Baker is with us in the studio. We're talking about sports agents. He happens to be one. You heard him say about being a lawyer. Jeff Garcia, one of his clients, other NFL players as well. So he certainly knows what he's talking about. And we're talking about the comments made by Nick Saban, alleging that there are some unscrupulous agents that he would liken them to being pimps. Let me go back again 24 years ago when you started out on this. How tough was it for you to get that first client? And when you were out there going against other established agents that were there representing, I mean, if they were doing things that were not what they should have been doing, how did you go against that? And how tough was it for you to establish yourself as a legitimate, honest agent?
Well, I had it a little bit easier because there's two ways you break into the business. One is go out and get a client, and the other is go out and work for someone who has a lot of clients. And when I came out, I was a lawyer for 3 years, and I joined up with Lee Steinberg in 1986. And Lee at the time was without question the dominant football agent, and you know it was a wonderful apprenticeship, because for the 5 years that I was there, I saw basically everything that was going on in the NFL. I mean, I was in the room as Troy Aikman's deal was negotiated many deals. Then the challenge was once I went off on my own, getting clients. It's fascinating. My first big client was Ken Harvey, who was a first rounder out of Cal, who at one point became the highest paid linebacker in the NFL. But it's funny, a lot of the reason that he ended up becoming my client is we had a mutual interest in Spider-Man. and was fascinated that I knew more about Spider-Man. You know, I hate to say that was my major qualifications. I mean, I guess there wasn't a salary cap then. But it brings up the point that success in this business is through some combination of skills, but also relationships. And the people who succeed are people who have both of those things.
Is it out of control as far as the representation of athletes today professionally?
I don't think it's out of control. I think there's abuses. I think what happened with SC is terrible. I think what's happening in Alabama is terrible. I think those same things were happening 25 years ago. I think they'll happen 25 years from now because I don't think there's any way to – I mean, it's sort of almost like looking at what's going on with the financial crisis. Every time you create one rule, someone will find another way to get around something. I think for every abuse you see, there's many other cases where very good work is done for players. But I definitely think it's a problem, and I'm glad that Nick Saban's taking it on.
Steve, I know that one coach told me, and this was a college basketball coach, he told me, he said that when he started coaching, he said the rule book, the NCAA rule book, was like this, about a half an inch thick, and now, you know, you need help carrying the damn thing. And I'm just wondering, every time there is an abuse that goes on, there's more legislation that comes from the NCAA trying to curb it. I mean, this is an ongoing contest between athletes, schools, and also the NCAA. I'm just wondering, are we going to be over-legislated in this area? Is it going to become more difficult? How do you see the landscape going forward?
I think that, I don't think that there's a huge problem. So I don't I think there's a problem. I mean, what happened with SC is a terrible thing, but I also think it seems like the Reggie Bush issue should have been pretty obvious at the time. When guys are driving around in cars and a lot of these abuses, it's like the guy from Casablanca collecting his winnings from Rick saying, I'm shocked that there's gambling going on here. I mean, the abuses are sitting right in front of people. Frankly, while I think what the NCAA does is largely good, I also have problems because I don't think what the NCAA does is necessarily following what's best for the athlete. I mean, for example, these players who have just gone to USC who weren't there when the abuses occurred, for them to have committed to a school and then not be able to play in a bowl game, I find that unfair. I find it unfair that a player playing for a school that loses his coach, the coach can just leave, but the player can't. So I don't necessarily feel that the interests are always being guarded of the athlete.
Does this come down to the compliance officer on the university campus? I mean, what responsibility do coaches? I mean, they're there to coach football players. I mean, they're not there to hold their hand or babysit them away from the field and everything. Does either Nick Saban or Pete Carroll or any other coach that has had an athlete get in trouble, are they really responsible to any degree?
I think without question they should be. I mean, I think that, you know, again, sometimes abuses are sitting right in front of your face. I mean, if some kid who doesn't come from money is driving around driving a Hummer on campus, they're probably someone who should be asking some questions. I think that's a concern. At the same time, I think that there's so much money involved. There's so much, there's so much money involved that there's always going to be abuses. The only way that there won't be abuses is if there's not money involved. I mean, I went to college at Tufts. We had a pristine program. I mean, there were no abuses at Tufts, but then again, I don't think any of the Tufts basketball players did anything besides lead their intramural team to a championship. So, you know, that's the difference.
Yeah, and there's nobody in the NBA from Tufts.
Tufts put one football player into the NFL, and I think his distinction was that he was the 53rd man on the 53-man roster.
We've got about 30 seconds before we have to leave you, but I'm just wondering the comments by Nick Saban. Shock value, do you think after a while people are just going to laugh and look the other way?
I think it probably triggers an extra review. It's been the fact that we're having this conversation right now. It's certainly on the front pages. I think the NFLPA is looking a little bit more closely this week than it was last week. So I think it could have some positive effect.
I want to thank you for coming in. I knew that when I saw this story, I had to get somebody from the other side, and I had to find out. I've known you for a long time. I didn't think you were a pimp, and now that you've cleared that picture up. Thanks a lot, Steve, for coming in.
Thanks a lot, man.
Again, Steve Baker, agent representing athletes, NFL athletes, including one-time Jeff Garcia. We'll take a break as we continue with more of you in Sports Byline.